on of Department of Science and Strategic Studies, Uris College, Vellore. I invite all the participants and our speaker of the day, Dr. Ajith Kanna, for this webinar session. So the session is over to Dr. Ajith Kanna. I think you have to unmute your microphone, Professor.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. You are audible now.
Sorry. Okay. Let me thank Thirumaran for giving this opportunity to give a lecture on a topic that is the most talked about subject in India and elsewhere in the world. Because the biggest gainer in this pandemic times is Zoom and other online developers. So it's the right topic that he has chosen, and I also just suggested, and he also readily accepted that, yes, I leave it to you, Ajith. You decide what you want to speak on. I was very, very happy to work on this topic ever since he suggested this topic. I want to thank my friend Gautam for suggesting my name to Thirumaran. And finally, I thank my my father, who is no more, Professor M.N.K. Bose, because why I thank him, not because he's my father. He also worked on classroom teaching all his life. His PhD was on towards redesigning the English component of the pre-service course for teachers at the school level. So it's about classroom teaching. Now we are talking about virtual classrooms. Anyway, I'm presenting three theses before you, before the virtual house, as the title clearly suggests: technology, society, and pedagogy. These three phenomena I'll be dealing with in detail if time permits. I mean, I'm sure if time will not permit me, he will stop me at the end of 35 minutes. But anyway, I'll try and rush through these three major topics. That is tradition versus modernity. Here it is virtuality. What was modernity in Christianity was different as compared to modernity in the 1980s and 1990s, my dear friends. For America,
Professor, you are not audible. Through now.
Can
you hear me now?
Yes, Professor.
You are loud and clear, sir.
Participants,
okay now?
I want everyone to mute your phones. Yeah, you are audible now, Professor.
Yeah, I had some kind of disturbance from the participants.
Sorry.
It's okay. No, I'm just saying, please unmute, mute their... this thing. Yeah. Okay. So Americans considered being Protestant is being modern. Now tradition. What is tradition in the 14th century, 15th century, medieval Europe or medieval India? For them, tradition was what was tradition in the medieval century for us was tradition. And now in the 1980s or even 19th century and 20th century, the modernity, the word modernity has become outdated for us now. Now we talk about post-modernism or post-modernity. So what I'm trying to drive a point here is traditional classroom for me was, when I was studying, my classroom was held under the tree. we were longing to go to a properly constructed classroom. So the change was happening every 10 years, 20 years, or 30 years. In linguistics, in language sciences, experts say every word changes its meaning after every 30 years. So same way, the changes happen in every field. And you should not be surprised that we are going towards virtual classrooms. That doesn't mean we are losing the root. The root remains, the content, the basic content remains, the basic structure remains. I am lecturing, you are listening. You'll be lecturing, I'll be listening. That basic structure of the classroom, the concept of a room, it can be in a canteen. In JNU, we used to have classes in the canteen. I remember my professor takes me outside to the lawn. During the winter, it's damn cold. We don't have any heating system in the classroom. So he would take all of us to the lawn under the sun. And we used to have the classrooms. Am I audible, guys?
Come on.
Am I audible?
Yes, yeah, sir. You are loud and clear. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So you are with me. Fine. So this is what was happening. And in Tamil Nadu or in Andhra, there was something called Thinnai Palli. In Andhra, it is called Arugubadi, where you have a raised platform on both the sides of the door. That is called Thinnai in Tamil, Arugu in Andhra, and Rock in Bengal, Ruak in Bengal. I don't know, in Hindi, I'm forgetting. So, but the phenomenon of Thinnai Palli or Arugubadi did not exist in east of India, did not exist in north of India or in Punjab, but it was there, but it was caste specific. Thinnai Palli or Gurukulam, for example, Guru, the master, Kulam, the family, or the clan, or the community. One particular community would gather and listen to their master. Gurukul. Kul is clan in Hindi or Sanskrit. Kulam is also community, but it was called family those days. So what was tradition and what was modern, I have a problem. It is the time that decides what is modern and tradition. It is about, now those days Christians were worried about the relationship between the nature and the God, man and the nature world. And because they had their internal fights between Christian world, Protestants, Calvinists, Baptists, Pentecostal, Methodist, and Catholics, they were fighting each other. 30 years of war. I'm reading a book called 30 Years of War. Between 1618 and 1648, 30 years of war, which really so that change, that what we are talking about. When Karl Marx was talking about the change is inevitable. Change is the only thing that doesn't change. He's talking about the 1830s and 1840s. Europe was in complete turmoil, political turmoil. Now we are in technological turmoil. I'm trying to give you the parallel. What was happening in the 1830s and 1930s, now 2020s. We are now entering into technology. Why technology? Why technology? Because science learns from evidence. What is the logic that scientists give? They suspect that everybody is infected with coronavirus, for example. So they think even if you go for a blood pressure checkup or diabetes checkup or, you know, a lipid profile, they will suspect. Now, if you go to any hospital, they will suspect Thirumaran, Ajith Kanna, or anybody who goes there, oh, this guy must be infected with something. So they take your sample for that coronavirus test also. And then they will come to a conclusion that out of so many people tested, some were negative, some were positive, though they were asymptomatic. So this is evidence that science learns from. The technology has divided us. I'm sure all the sociologists, all the humanities experts will say it has created a huge divide between rich and the poor. it has created a huge gap between haves and have-nots. Have some, have enough, have little, have more. So these poor and the elite, rich and the elite, but one good thing that has happened in this technological change, as far as virtual classroom is concerned, this class and caste is impossible. You cannot identify which caste he belongs to. The technology will not recognize this Dalit guy should not be permitted. You should not be allowed to enter this classroom. Trimaran will have a tough time to do that. Ajith Kanna will have a tough time to discriminate a Dalit boy and a Brahmin boy, or a Dalit girl or a Muslim girl. So that is the biggest achievement in technology. As far as this caste divide is concerned, it is out of the question. That is the biggest sociological advantage that we have in technology. Having said that, the divide is there between rich and the poor, those who cannot access. I read in the newspapers that 845 million students have no facility, and 430 million students have no access to internet facility at all. What are we doing with them? So that's where the sociological, this social change is happening. This divide, it's all interconnected. I'm connecting everything together because lack of time. So you can ask me more in detail when the question begins. So one good thing that has happened in technology is caste has been eradicated, I would say, destroyed, decimated. People like Periyar and Ambedkar will be happy to see this kind of virtual classrooms. But what are the advantages of virtual classrooms? One advantage is there is no embarrassment, there is no apprehension in role playing. All language teachers know what I'm talking about. When we give a situation between a shopkeeper and a customer, that role play. Between a teacher and a student, the role play. Between a husband and a wife, the role play in the classroom that we all learned in language classrooms. So that kind of thing with this augmented reality, this artificial intelligence, teachers can create three-dimensional effect, and they can have a more, facial expressions, this non-verbal clues like body language, the gesture, the facial expressions. You can have improved graphics in computers, which allow students to infer more meaning than in the classrooms, the direct one, the traditional classrooms that we are talking about. This technology puts students in control of their avatar. What do I mean by that? Not the teacher. It is the students. It is the students who are in control, which meant they could control, they could explore and interact independently. They can play. They can play 10 times, 20 times. The repetition is more accessible than in the classroom. The teachers get terribly vexed, terribly disappointed with some students who ask for, please, ma'am, please, sir, please repeat what you said. That is not possible. That kind of disadvantage that you have can be solved with this augmented reality classrooms, virtual classrooms, virtual universities that you have. When I was talking about the tradition, my classroom was under the tree somewhere in Chennai. We were longing to go to a properly constructed classroom. When we ever go to the building, that was our traditional classroom, the tree under the tree. The tree was a traditional classroom. But in JNU, tree was a modern classroom. Whoever goes to the canteen, whoever has a class under the tree, they would look at us as if, we are ultra modern. We are very organized. The kind of discussion that we used to have over a cup of tea. So tradition or modern or, that is very, very complicated phenomenon that has to be understood. Only with the time can one understand what is modern and what is traditional. As far as the social issues are concerned, social changes are concerned, you know, I was reading this article by Zoya Hassan. She says, during this lockdown, 145 million laborers have lost their job in India alone. So who has gained? Who has gained from this lockdown? Who has gained from this pandemic? People like Bill Gates, people like Google Classrooms, people like Sundar Pichai, people like Mark Zuckerberg, they have gained enormously from their Zoom classrooms, Google Chat, Google Classrooms, Botim, and other social media and other online platforms. You know, many more are likely to be sacked from their jobs in India. Once when the lockdown is lifted, many more will lose their jobs. Now we have something called balcony classes. So this technology has again created one more class called balcony class. So we are least bothered about the migrant laborers, that their children who have lost their education, who have lost their dignity, and this technology has done a bit of damage to this aspect of our social life. You know what? So this is one of the major challenges. Like when computers were introduced in India, some millions lost their jobs. I still remember in the early 90s, late 80s and the early 90s, pre-internet era, my brother was very happy to do computer science. And of course, he was right in doing computer science in the early 90s. All my friends in JNU were placed in some multinational companies in the mid-90s and late 90s because they were doing MCA or M-Tech or B-Tech or BSc computer science. Little did they realize that many million Indians have lost their jobs. Now, online will replace the manual force, the manual labor, the workforce that was in place. The rest of the manual labor will be completely replaced by online. Now, where are we? How are we talking? How are we having our classrooms? How are we having our lectures? I miss the human touch. I miss the hug from the Timaran. I miss the handshake from my friend. I miss the kind of human touch and the interaction with Gautam. I would have met him at Thirumaran invited me to Vellore College. I miss all that fun. You know, I'm not trying to be conservative or that way traditional. I am traditional in that sense because I am what I am because of that kind of tradition. So suddenly moving to virtual reality or modern, so-called postmodern reality, I miss something that I enjoy. That's my only concern. That's the only concern. The fear is so many more millions will lose their jobs as the technology advances. Many more will lose their jobs, and most of them might commit suicide because of the depression of having lost the job and also the dignity. Are we bothered about the human touch? When humanity died a century ago or two centuries ago, I wonder. So let me now go to the pedagogical change. That is the last theme of my talk. How many more minutes I have, Thirumaran? Thirumaran?
Professor, you can go ahead. Your time is
okay.
Still on.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Okay. So, as far as pedagogy is concerned, as far as pedagogical change is concerned, the experts say only 90 minutes of classroom teaching can be effective. That is 1 hour, 30 minutes, or 1 hour, 15 minutes, 75 minutes of teaching can be effective. That is the research that says. What does that mean? So now we are going to have only 35 minutes. So where are we? Now, believe me or not, I don't know if Thirumaran is aware of this. My daughter is busy with her online classes. They have only for 30 minutes or 35 minutes. And how did they decide? I don't know. Only 35 minutes of this kind of classroom interaction can be effective or can be less strenuous. I don't know what research has gone into this kind of classroom, virtual classroom teaching and learning. So only 30 minutes or 35 minutes classes would happen for my daughter. So maybe Thirumaran is aware of it. That is why he made it 35 minutes. So anyway, as far as classroom, traditional classroom teaching is concerned, 90 minutes was found to be very effective. Let me quote something from my father's thesis. It's quite interesting how my dad's thesis has been outdated. That's why I'm reading this one. He says, it's outdated. It was submitted in 1989, and now it is 2020. In less than 20 years, in less than 20, 21 years, this is outdated. What is that he's saying? The salient features of the interactive materials. He says, learning from classrooms has four samples. One, to glean from the classroom data and the reading materials, the principles of the structural approach. Two, the principles of the communicational approach. Three, the principles of procedure of presenting new language items. Four, the principles and procedure of drill practice in English classes. Drill practice, out of the question. It is completely outdated that all these four categories, four samples that my father was trying to analyze do not hold waters in 2020. The other citation that I would like to say is about several committees. The Secondary Education Commission to declare that any method, good or bad, should link up the teacher and his pupils into an organic relationship with constant mutual interaction. Out of the question. Thanks to Mark Zuckerberg, thanks to Bill Gates, thanks to Sundar Pichai, thanks to Nadella, Satya Nadella and others. The Kunzru Committee, 1964, recommended that training colleges should pay attention to the personal development of trainees. And the Kothari Commission, 1964, insisted on healthy coexistence of training colleges and cooperating schools for research and practice. My dear friends, all gone for us with this virtual classrooms. All gone for a big six. So what is that we are now into? What is the change? The change is the technology. We have to adapt. Adapt sometime or the other. Maybe you and I, all of us right now, we are longing to go get back to the classroom. I want to see my students in June or July, whenever the lockdown is lifted, whenever the pandemic fear is over. We are all waiting to see our friends, I mean colleagues, students, and the classrooms, right? But what if the next pandemic outbreak comes again to haunt us, which is likely to happen in 2025? Or in the near future. So I think this is the right time to shift from a kind of a classroom teaching to, we also should have this in reserve. This online classrooms arrangements should be kept in reserve, like stadium or many halls are ready with the beds for the future coronavirus patients in Mumbai, Pune, Chennai, and other cities. So we have to keep this also in reserve. let me quote another article which I read yesterday in the Indian Express. An historian, I'm sure you must have all read this this piece, an historian called Peter Frankopan talks about the inclusivity and tolerance. Are we talking about, why should I quote this article? Inclusivity. Are we inclusive in this kind of virtual classroom? Thirumalan was saying only first 100 will be allowed to enter, I mean, join the meeting. So the other other 100 or 200 or 500 who want to come to the class, who want to join the meeting, are excluded. So how best can we put this into use? If it is a paid Zoom classroom, we can allow as many people as we want, it seems. So again, it is paid. It is paid just like university, you pay the registration fees. Now we are paying online. So everything is going to change. The nature of classroom is going to change. The nature of registration is going to change. The nature of the teaching methodology is going to change drastically. You know, everything is going to be, you know, a virtual reality, a virtual classroom where I'll be talking. There'll be no way, you know, it's so boring for me, though I've been talking for the last half hour or so. There is no interaction. I don't even know whether you're listening to me, whether you are looking at me, or whether you are taking notes, or whether I'm making sense. Some of you would have the urge to, interrupt me. Ajith, come on, don't. I want to interrupt you. I want to ask you something which I don't agree with. All that fun is missing. I mean, I'm trained like that. Maybe once I'm used to this kind of virtual classroom, I'll not be bothered about that kind of, classroom environment. So the whole environment, the atmosphere has changed. What is that change that we are seeing? This is the change that we are seeing. But the companies like Oculus Rift or HTC Vive, they are now developing a kind of software where teachers will be allowed to design three-dimensional interactive environments for their students. Three-dimensional interactive environments. So whatever my dad said in 1989, whatever Frankopan said about inclusivity, all that is disproved. All that has been outdated. What is that we are supposed to do? We have to update with the latest developments that are happening, that are given to us in this, at least in this pandemic period. The best option is this, because human contact is detrimental, is dangerous. So every human being, I see every human being on the way as a bomb, that he's going to kill me with this coronavirus. So let me conclude by saying that I'll summarize what I said just now. The point is to excite.
1 minute.
Yeah. I'll finish. The point is to excite students' minds, people's minds. What do I mean by that? I can give you information, but that information is going to get outdated very soon. But if I teach you how to think about it, like Socrates said, I cannot teach you anything, I can only make you think. But if I teach you how to think about it, I can make sure the love of knowledge will stay with you.